principal sir, vice principal ma'am, coordinators, parents, respected teachers and my dear friends, it gives me immense pleasure in welcoming you all to the virtual science exhibition Gyan Theertha, a journey of science, proudly hosted by the Department of Science of our esteemed institution. Dr. Radhakrishnan has rightly said, a life of joy and happiness is possible only on the basis of knowledge and science. Science is a systematic way of carefully and thoroughly observing nature and using consistent logic to evaluate results. Science in everyday life cannot be separated. Every cell in our body, every grain that we consume, and every luxury that we enjoy is a result of science. It is the only subject that has brought revolutionary improvement in human life since time immemorial. To develop a complete mind, one must study the science of art and as well as the art of science. The basic aim of science is to seek the simplest solutions to complex problems. Science is a self-correcting process. This way, science is an integral part of student culture. It teaches us to constantly learn, observe, experiment, and evolve. Our school has always been instrumental in developing scientific, rational, and critical thinking in us students. Today's science is tomorrow's technology, and through this science exhibition, our school has provided a wonderful opportunity for us to create and innovate. All outstanding work in science is a result of immense zeal applied to a great idea, and my friends at Presidency have done just that. Today, our young scientists are going to enthrall and fascinate you with their stunning exhibits and experiments. So, stay tuned and get ready to be amazed. I wish everyone a joyful experience throughout the session. Once again, I welcome one and all to our virtual science exhibition, Gyan Theertha, a journey of science. Thank you.
Nice to see you. Good morning.
Good morning, sir.
How are you, sir?
I'm fine. We are all missing the students as well as all of you, and it's so nice of you to come to school, pay a visit. What made you come along to school?
Sir, science department is hosting a virtual science exhibition.
Oh, very great. That's nice. It's a good initiative even at these pandemic times.
Yes,
but how are you getting connected with the students?
So first, we have planned a theme, sir. The theme is Gyan Theertha. Gyan is derived from Vignan, and the meaning is knowledge. Theertha means holy water, and knowledge is unstoppable during this pandemic situation also. It spreads like a holy water everywhere, sir.
Okay. And of course, knowledge is always a great power. But you all have been working behind the scene in giving this knowledge to our children, working hard, preparing all those content, and as a remote teacher you have been doing a wonderful job. But how did you get connected with regard to practical things, because this requires a lab?
Yes, sir.
And in what way did you inspire them or encourage them to take part in experimental learning?
So pandemic is for the country, not for our students.
It's not only the country, the whole world.
And children's creativity was not stopped at, sir. And there was no lockdown for students for their knowledge and creativity.
So the students have actually performed the experiments back at home. We were successfully, we were able to unlab and get the things done by them.
So they collected things from home and around the home.
Yes, yeah. They use materials which were available in their classes.
Okay.
And they did experiments both related to syllabus as well as out of the box.
Okay.
And submitted to us in the form of videos.
Mm. That's nice. So, how did that video take place?
So, the students sent the videos to us. We have proofread it and asked them to edit it and send it back to us.
Okay. And, yes, you want to say something?
Yes. Sir, a comment link was shared. And the best video from that was selected for the virtual science exhibitions.
So you created a virtual lab, home lab, but definitely the children are missing labs in our school.
Yes, sir.
Nice of you to come and visit the lab. But let us see how the lab is still there in our school, so that you get a kind of a nostalgic experience of the good days when children used to come to the lab.
Yes.
So let's go and see something.
It is within us, sir.
I think still the plants are maintained.
Hi all, today I, Ritvik Jagdish from grade 8A, am going to demonstrate the working of an Arduino radar.
The materials you will be requiring for this project are an Arduino Uno board, an ultrasonic sensor, a servo motor, and a breadboard. These are the four materials, the main materials which we are going to use for the project.
Now that we are done with the connection part of the Arduino project, now we upload the code into the board, which gives it all the information. It instructs it what all are connected to it, from where power has to leave the board and where from where power has to enter it. Then we even have how does the servo motor have to function, how does the ultrasonic sensor have to function. Please excuse this, I've just added some strength. If I did not added this, it would have just fallen like this, and you know what would happen. It would stop working at the moment it falls, because it needs to be connected to this. So let's begin uploading the code. For that, let's dive into my screen.
Now let us open the Arduino IDE, which is the official coding platform for coding Arduino project. This code provides information instructions to the Arduino board, which conducts the programs listed in this. Now, we already have typed out the code over here. So, we just copy paste the code from the notepad into the Arduino IDE. Then we click on the verify button, which just verifies. And asks us to save this sketch folder. As you can see, this is in Java format, but no, I won't save this. So this is the taskbar which shows the status of the program. So this has indicated an error here. Yes, this full stop. Okay, this full stop. Now let's verify this. I won't save this again. So we have our program running and ready. Now this code only should be uploaded to the board. Now just click on this upload button. This will ask again. We have the Arduino Uno on COM3, so it acts like USB ports. I won't be saving this. So once I click on upload, this will start working over here. So you can see the ultrasonic sensor has already started working. It has received the code from the screen and has already begun to function as per its instructions in the code. This, now the only thing left to do is enter the processing code into the codes. So you can see the ultrasonic sensor has already started working. It has received the code from the screen and has already begun to function as per its instructions in the code. This, now the only thing left to do is enter the processing code into the codes. Now let us head into the processing part of this program. First we open processing app. This is processing 3.5.4, version 3.5.4. Now we open the code folder and we open the processing code. So this is the processing code which I've already typed out. Now we copy paste this code, the whole code. Okay, I have to copy paste it again. So I copy paste this whole code, Control C, and then paste this in the processing app. Then we change this to COM3 because that's where our Arduino COM was there, but the processing area just sets it to automatically to COM5. So now if we run this program, we will be able to see that the radar keeps moving on the screen. Now, if I place a glue gun in front of it or a glue stick in front of it, we are able to observe that the radar has captured that something is in its path. Now, we can also observe that this, the distance over here, although it's blurred up over here, we can observe that the maximum distance which can be captured by this is 30 to 35 centimeter. Thus, we come to a conclusion that this radar is not though completely useful, but it is also an excellent DIY you can do at home. So, I hope you like my video. Thank you.
Hello everyone. My name is Aditya Sanjay from Class 6D. Today, I'm going to show you my brush board that I made for the science exhibition. So, the brush board contains a brush, a battery, a motor, a connector and a switch. So when I switch it on, the brush board starts to move. So the electric current passes to the from the battery to the motor, and it has a small nut which I stuck it with hot glue, which makes it unbalanced, and this is called a closed circuit. Now let me show you how this works. Is moving, so it's spinning now, and now I am going to switch it off. And now when I switch it off, it has become an open circuit. So now all the electric current is not passing from the battery to the motor. So now brush board has stopped. So when I switch it on, you can see my hand gets vibrated. Let me show you. See, you can see my hand is getting vibrated. So this proves that when I put a small nut, when I put a small thing on the motor against the big thing, it starts to vibrate. This is how your phones vibrate like that. Thank you.
Hello everyone. I am Ria Day. Today I am presenting the gravity truck to you. In this experiment, I will be using the concepts of gravity to move a truck forward. As you can see, the truck's rear axle is connected to the pulley by a rope. On the other side of the pulley is the weight. Because of gravity, the weight falls down pulling the rope. The falling weight turns the pulley clockwise. As the pulley rotates, it reverses the direction of the pull, causing the axle to turn clockwise. Thus, the truck moves forward. So, to summarize, as the weight moves down, the truck moves forward. Now, I would like to show a small demo of the actual truck.
This is my actual gravity truck. This is the weight. This is the pulley. And that is the rear axle. Now, I'm going to show how the gravity truck moves. 3, 2, 1, go.
Good morning to all. My name is Pranav Aspuri from class 9C and today I am going to explain about the project Newton's Cradle. So Newton's Cradle is based on two simple principles, the law of conservation of momentum and law of conservation of energy. So law of conservation of momentum states that when two objects collide, the initial momentum is always equal to the final momentum, whereas law of conservation of energy states that energy can neither be created nor destroyed, but can only be converted and transferred. So as you can see, when I let go of this ball, the energy here is transferred from to each ball. So as you see over here, two principles apply over here, the law of conservation of momentum and law of conservation of energy. So in the first swing, the initial momentum is transferred through all the balls until it reaches the last ball. So here we can see the law of conservation of energy taking place. The initial momentum is being transferred from every single ball until it reaches the end. And when the last ball reaches gains the momentum, it is equal to the initial momentum. So from this we can say that both of these are the basic principles of this project. So the Newton's Cradle is also known by many names. One of them is Newton's Balls, Executive Ball Clicker and Newton's Rocker. Thank you.
Welcome. I am G.R. Balakarthikeya from Class 6E. We are going to see the making, working and the principle of a pinhole camera. A pinhole camera is a simple optical device without mirrors or lenses. Now coming to the making of a pinhole camera. You will need an opaque cardboard box. On one face of the box, make a small hole with a pin. On the other face of the box, make a square cut and then cover it with a translucent paper like the tracing paper. The principle of a pinhole camera is light passes through the hole. The top tip of the candle is seen at the bottom of the screen and the bottom tip of the candle is seen at the top of the screen, that is, the image of the candle is inverted. Now, for testing the working, light a candle and move the candle front and back and fix the position when you get a clear inverted image of the candle.
Today I'm going to tell you how to make your own projector at your home. The first step is take a box. The second step is take a magnifying glass. Take a magnifying glass and place it on one of its lateral sides. Then take a pencil and mark its position. To avoid any interference, you can cut these both edges. after cutting the edges, take a black paper. Cover the inside of this projector with black paper to obtain sharper images. The next step is take a 15 cm scale and place it from one end. Measure 9 cm and mark a dot. After measuring 9 cm, take the same pen and draw a line from one end to the other end, passing through the dot you had put. Take a protractor and then measure 55 degrees and mark it. Take an empty box and place it at one of the corners. Then take a mirror and with 16 cm and 9 cm. Place it carefully at an angle of 55 degrees which you have marked and make it lean on the box for support. Take a 15 cm scale and then place it outside from where the mirror is starting. And then take a pen and mark 6 cm. Measure 5 cm from the place you have started. After measuring 5 cm, from that point, mark 5 cm from the bottom. Do the same for the other side. Take two thumb pins and then poke them into the cardboard. For other side. So that the smartphone doesn't fall down, I have taken 4 rubber pieces and will place them on the thumb pins. Do the same for the other 3. After we have placed the 4 rubber pieces, then we place the magnifying glass on the place we have cut. After we have placed the magnifying glass, then place your smartphone on the rubber pieces. When the light rays from the video on the screen fall on the mirror, it gets laterally inverted. When the reflected rays from the mirror pass through the convex lens, it becomes inverted again, which in turn helps it obtaining an erect and a proper image. Now you can use the projector and your projector is ready. Switch off the lights and play your favorite video and project it to the wall. Enjoy.
My name is Manish and I am from class 8D. Today I am going to explain about the product Tesla coil. Tesla coil is a small, simple coil that creates high voltage electric field in the air when small input of power 9 volt battery is provided. The electric field is strong enough to blow only CFL bulbs. The principle was invented by Sir Nikola Tesla, who also holds the record for inventing induction motors, AC currents, neon bulb, remote control, etc. And things required for making a Tesla coil is 9 volt battery, a PVC pipe surrounded by copper wire, aluminium foil, transistor, resistor, switch, and a receiver circuit. And the principle of this project is Tesla coil works with the principle of electromagnetic induction. As per this principle, when a conductor is placed under a varying magnetic field, current will be included inside the conductor. In Tesla coil project, this conductor will be called as secondary coil and the varying magnetic field will be produced by the primary by the passing of oscillating current through the primary coil. As you can see, when you switch on the Tesla coil, and this is the receiver circuit which we got, and when you just put it over it,
you can see the red light without any connection. You can see the red light glowing there. And there's no connection, as you can see. As soon as you take it all around the circle, like this, you just put it over it, you can see the red light going on. And there's no connection between it. It's not even touching. Like that.
One.
Thank you for watching.
Hello friends, today I am going to show you the working of an electroscope. So I have a glass bottle, I have a bottle cap which is inserted with a copper wire, and I have made a hook at the end of the copper wire. So I have placed two aluminium leaves inside the hook. Now I am going to place these things inside the bottle. I am going to charge a scale by rubbing on my hands. When I take it close to the copper wire, the two leaves will repel. When I take it away from the copper wire, it comes to the original position. The charges from the scale flow through the copper wire and they reach to the aluminium leaves. So the aluminium leaves divert. So this shows that like charges ripple. So the principle behind this experiment is that like charges ripple and unlike charges attract.
organizing them in a layer density tile. But first, we need to understand what is density. So let's see. Density of a substance is the ratio of its mass to its volume.
I have used these liquids in my liquid density tile. They are, starting from the bottom, honey, glycerin, colored milk, castor oil, olive oil, and enamel thinner.
Here, more denser liquids settle at the bottom of the glass, while the less denser ones float on top. In this tar, the most bottom of the glass is honey. The one above honey is glycerin, which is not clearly visible. Above the glycerin is colored milk to different shades. Above milk lies castor oil, and above castor oil lies olive oil. Above olive oil and the top of the tower, which is the least dense in all these liquids, lies enamel thinner.
This shows that different liquids have different densities. Thank you.
Greetings to one and all present here. I, Shirazi Varanasi from class 7B, will be demonstrating an experiment to explain the process of addition. So first, I'm going to take an empty glass which has nothing in it. Now what I'm going to do is I'm going to take a playing card and place it over the glass. Now I'm going to take a small coin and put it on the other end of the card. As you can see, the card falls down. As many as ever times we try it, the same process happens. Now, I'm going to take some water and fill it in the glass up to the brim. As you can see, the water is now filled up to the brim of the glass. I'm going to do the same process by putting the card right on the water like this and gently placing the coin. As you can see, the coin is now equally balanced and is not falling off. This is due to the process of addition. Addition is a property of water by which water binds with any hard substance on it. Over here, the water which is filled to the brim of the glass is binding with the card, thus making it support the weight of the coin. Hope you understood the process. Thank you
everyone. My name is Svetlana Patro from class 7B and today I do an experiment on teeth staining. So the materials required are water, tea, coffee, coke, grape juice and a few eggshells. So the first step is take one eggshell and put it in water. Take another eggshell and put it in tea. Take another eggshell and put it in coffee. Take another eggshell and put it in coke. And the last eggshell in grape juice. Now, we have to keep these eggshells overnight and let's see what happens next day. Now, I've kept these eggshells overnight in water, tea, coffee, coke, grape juice. Now, let's see which liquid stains our teeth the most. This is water. This is tea. Coffee. This is coke. And this is grape juice. So now, as you can see, grape juice stains our teeth the most, and water doesn't stain at all. So, in conclusion, grape juice stains our teeth the most, and water doesn't stain at all. Thank you.
My name is Tejushri. I am from class 7D. Today, I am going to tell you the materials required for this activity. The materials required for this activity are 6 eggshells, 6 plastic or glass bowls, tea, coffee, vinegar, soda, cola and lemon juice.
Hello, I am Neha from 7D. This is what I did to verify the effects of different beverages on teeth. Fill 6 bowls with soda, cola, lemon juice, tea and vinegar. Place a piece of eggshell in each bowl. Every day, remove the eggshell from each bowl and examine it. Write down what you have observed. Repeat this for 4 days and decide which of these drinks should be avoided. Eggshell in soda, day 1. No visible change in appearance of eggshell. Eggshell in soda, day 2. No noticeable change in appearance. Eggshell in soda, day 3. Not much change in appearance of eggshell. Eggshell in soda, day 4. Slightly dissolved due to the formation of carbonic acid. Eggshell in cola, day 1. Slight discoloration of eggshell. Eggshell in cola, day 2. Color of eggshell has turned darker. Eggshell in cola, day 3. Color of eggshell turned light brown and blisters are noticeable. Eggshell in cola, day 4. Eggshell has turned dark brown. Eggshell in lemon juice, day 1. Noticeable blisters formed on eggshell. Eggshell in lemon juice, day 2. Eggshell is partially dissolved. Eggshell in lemon juice, day 3. Eggshell softened due to the loss of calcium. Eggshell in lemon juice, day 4. More of eggshell is dissolved. It has reduced in size and thickness. Eggshell in coffee, day 1. Slight discoloration of eggshell. Eggshell in coffee, day 2. Color of eggshell turned brownish. Eggshell in coffee, day 3. Eggshell in coffee turned darker. Eggshell in coffee, day 4. Eggshell has turned dark brown.
In day 1, the eggshell has turned slightly brown in color. The egg has turned a little dark brown in day 2. Egg has turned darker in day 3. In day 4, the egg has turned dark brown in color. In day 1, the eggshell in vinegar has dissolved. In vinegar, there are a few bubbles formed on the eggshell in day 2. In day 3, there are few more bubbles formed on the eggshell. In day 4, there are a few more bubbles formed on the eggshell.
Observation in this activity. The eggshell in this experiment got stained and gradually dissolved on prolonged immersion in tea. carbonated drinks such as cola cause the teeth to stain the deepest as they contain high amounts of sugar. Acidic drinks such as soda and vinegar cause tooth decay as they dissolve the calcium present in the teeth.
After 4 days of this experiment, it is concluded that carbonated soft drinks, tea, coffee and acidic juices can have damaging effects on your teeth. Tea and coffee were found to cause darker stains compared to other drinks. Acidic juices like soda, cola, lemon juice or vinegar are more harmful and can erode calcium faster, thus weakening the teeth.
Hello friend, today I will be showing you the process of electrolysis. So what is electrolysis? The process by which an electrolyte splitting into its constituents when electric current is passed through it. So how does this process occur? A DC electrical power source is connected with two electrodes and is placed inside water. At the cathode, a reduction reaction takes place and hydrogen gas is formed. Whereas in the anode, an oxidation reaction takes place forming oxygen gas. Now we will be performing the experiment. So I have two pencils sharpened at the two ends and I have stuck it to the glass. In the glass I have water, I have a circuit consisting of two batteries and two wires. Now we will be connecting this two pencils with the wire. Now we are able to see some gas bubbles are rising. This concludes that water is dividing into constituents, hydrogen and oxygen. The hydrogen is formed in the cathode and oxygen is formed in the anode. Electroplating is an application of electrolysis. Electrolysis is used in electroplating some materials which corrode easily, such as wheel rims, taps, jewelry and tin cans. The rims of wheels are electroplated with chromium so that they get a shiny appearance and do not corrode. Taps are electroplated with chromium to give it a shiny appearance and prevent it from corrosion. Jewelry is electroplated with gold to give it a shiny appearance so that it can attract customers and it does not corrode. Tin can is electroplated with iron. As you know, tin cans are used for food storage. Tin is less reactive than iron, so it can be electroplated, which prevents from the food being poisoned.
Hello everyone, my name is Tanuj and I am from class 8C. Today I am going to do an experiment. The name of the experiment is Rising Water Experiment. For this experiment, you will need a glass bottle, some colored water, a tray, a candle and some matchsticks. The first step of this experiment is we light the candle. Now the second step is we take the colored water and pour it in the tray. Now the third step is we take the glass bottle and flip it on the candle until it puts out like this. Now as you can see, the water is rising up slowly. This is because when the candle puts off, the oxygen created inside creates a vacuum in the glass bottle, which results in rising of the water. Thank you.
Hi, my name is Deva and I am from class 80. Electroplating is an application of electrolysis. Using electroplating, we can deposit a layer of desired material on any other material. The material to be coated with the layer is used as anode. The material of which the coating is to be obtained is used as cathode. Some preventive uses of electroplating are prevent to corrosion. Chromium is electroplated metals like iron to make taps, car parts, wheel rims, etc. Gold or silver is electroplated on jewelry, etc. It improves overall quality and longevity. Now let's go to the experiment. Today I am going to show you the electroplating of iron nail and copper nail. The electrolyte taken as copper sulfate. The electrodes is iron nail and copper nail. The iron nail is cathode and the copper nail is anode. And iron nail is negative terminal and the copper nail is positive terminal. Now I'm connecting the terminals. Light shown on the connection is complete. Now light shown on the connection is complete. Now I will take back in 5, 4, 3, 2. Now we can see that a layer of copper is uniformly deposited over iron. Thank you. Have a nice day.
Hello all. Now I am going to show all the process of sublimation. Sublimation is a process where a solid substance directly converts into a gas. So the materials required in this experiment are a sublimable substance like naphthalene balls or camphor, and then we need some heat which is provided by this candle, and we also have ice cubes so that the camphor condenses on the surface. So I am going to start the experiment. So I will be heating this. So we need a mixture. So here I have camphor and salt. So it would take some time, so we need to be continuously heating it. So we can hear the sound of this camphor turning into a gas. So now I take it out. So after heating it continuously for 2 minutes, we can see the following observation. The camphor here has deposited down. So you can see on my finger. And you can see here also some more camphor is there. And we have salt in this. So we can see clearly that the camphor and salt has been separated. But if you heat a little more, the total camphor will come into this. So it is not fully separated, but we can still do it for some more time. Thank you. Hi guys, after heating for 10 minutes continuously, we can clearly see that the salt and this camphor have been separated. So this is the salt and this is the camphor particle. So now I am going to prove that this is camphor by heating it. I am going to light this up. So we can see that it's burning. So we can clearly see that this is camphor. Thank you.
Thank you.
I'm Rishik from class 7A. Today I'm going to be talking about the human digestive system. The human digestive system is a complex organ system that consists of mouth, esophagus, stomach, liver, gallbladder, pancreas, small intestine, large intestine. In the mouth where digestion starts, there is teeth that help in grinding of food. And there is saliva that produces salivary amylase that help in the digestion of starch into maltose. From there, the food goes into the esophagus where the muscles in front of the food relax and the muscles behind the food contract. This pushes the food into the stomach. In the esophagus, no digestion happens. But when it enters the stomach, it is full of hydrochloric acid. But however, the stomach is protected by a layer of gastric mucosa. The hydrochloric acid kills all the germs of the food. Protein is broken down in the stomach and partial digestion of food happens in the stomach. From the stomach, the food goes into the small intestine. The small intestine is divided into three parts, jejunum, ileum and duodenum. In the small intestine, digestion is entirely complete and the digestive juices in the liver and pancreas enter here and digest the food. After that, in the small intestine, starch is broken down into glucose, proteins is broken down into amino acids and fats are broken down into simpler substances. In the small intestine, after digestion is complete, small finger-like projections called villi and absorb the food. In the large intestine, all water is absorbed and the undigested and unwanted waste is thrown out of the body through the rectum and the anus in the form of feces.
Today I am going to show you my working model of our urinary system. Healthy kidneys filter about half a cup of blood every minute, removing waste and extra water to make urine. The urine flows from our kidneys to the bladder through two thin tubes of muscle called ureters on each side of your bladder. The bladder stores our urine. So now I'm going to show you the working of my model. For that I'm going to use some colored water. So now, you can clearly see how our urinary system works. Thank you.
And here is our carpals. This is our wrist. There is a joint present here. As we know, joint is a place where two bones meet and join together. There is gliding joint present over here. The gliding joint allows us to move our wrist back and forth and to the sides. There are two bones over here. That is the radius and ulna. We have our humerus in our upper arm, that is over here. Most of the bones are present in our limbs. Let me show you the working of the model. Wow, that was in fact nice. This is how our hand works. Thank you.
Hello everybody, I am Astha Pikmar of grade 7B. Today I will be performing an experiment to show that vinegar and baking soda when mixed together produce carbon dioxide which is enough to inflate a balloon. Here I have a balloon and this is a funnel. I will add in baking soda with the help of the funnel. Okay, I fill this balloon. Here I have a bottle with some 5% vinegar. We will now put this balloon over the head of the bottle. And pouring all the baking soda from the balloon. Okay, so this is the balloon. It has inflated, as you can see. Why did this balloon get inflated? This balloon got inflated because when I added baking soda, which is a base, to vinegar, which is an acid, they both performed neutralization reaction, which was enough, which produced enough carbon dioxide to fill this balloon. So this was an experiment to prove that when acids and bases react, they perform neutralization, which produces some salts and carbon dioxide.
The movement of the paddle boat is very similar to that of a fish. The rubber band acts as a muscle which can expand and contract. The paddle acts as the tail fin which can generate movement with the help of the rubber band which acts as the muscle. The bottle is the body which helps it to float on water and reduces resistance while moving.
Drip irrigation is a technique in which water is supplied drop by drop near the plant roots through small openings called drippers. This method avoids wastage of water and is good for places with scarcity of water. In this model, you can see the water falling drop by drop on the plant. Thank you.
Hi all, today I'm going to speak about microgreens. So what are microgreens? Like sprouts, microgreens are young vegetable. However, sprouts and microgreens are not the same. So let's now discuss about some of the health benefits. So microgreens might offer several benefits as an addition to the diet. They are rich in nutrients. Many fresh plant products provide vitamins, minerals, and fiber. These nutrients can help with preventing a range of diseases, managing weight, boosting both mental and physical health and well-being. Microgreens can offer all of these benefits and possibly more. Kale is available as a microgreen as well as a regular vegetable. Antioxidant content. Many plant-based foods are good source of vitamins, minerals, and antioxidants. Vitamins and minerals play hundreds of roles in essential bodily processes, and all of these are present in microgreens. Microgreens are really good for health, and hope you all have it for your diet. Stay safe, stay healthy. Thank you.
Hi, my name is Kapil and today I am going to show about composting, which is organic decomposition. I have a bucket with holes on all sides. I have put remix powder at the base. This powder is used for composting. It helps manage the moisture and smell in the pile. Then I layer the pile with food waste. After adding a layer of food waste, I again added a layer of remix powder. Repeat this process until the bin is full. After the bin is full, close the bin and leave it in a shady area for 1 month to 45 days. After a month, most of the things have been decomposed by the help of maggots and other microorganisms. Compost that we get serves as a nutrient for the plants growing in our home garden. This is easy. You can also compost and reduce the waste in the landfills. Thank you.
Hello everyone. My name is Amandita and I am from class 6B. Today I am going to demonstrate how to make a recycled paper. Materials required are newspaper, aluminium foil and a rolling pin, hot water and strainer. First, take a newspaper and cut them into smaller pieces. Soak the newspaper bits in hot water for around 30 minutes to an hour. After an hour, mix the newspaper bits to form a pulp. Now, I have kept the pulp ready. Now, take an aluminium foil and cut it in the shape and size of the paper you want to make it. Make holes in the aluminium foil so that the extra water can get strained. Now, I am using a used aluminium foil out of Choco's box. Now, take a stack of newspapers and place the aluminium foil on it. Now, take the pulp and spread the pulp on the aluminium foil. Now, take another aluminium foil and cover on top of the pulp. Now, take a rolling pin and roll it like this for it to spread evenly. Now, let it dry for at least 24 hours to make a recycled paper like this. We can also add dried leaves and petals on the pulp to make patterns. Thank you.
In the village named Lata near the Uttarakhand district. I had soon even shifted to a new village, and the village name was Traini near the borders of the Tibet. When I was at the age of 22, I was a widow and I had a small kid. And even I was elected for the leader of the Mahila Mangal Dal. It was an organization to save the community forest, and it was also related to the Chikku movement. I was awarded with 2 awards by J. Ram Ramesh. Thank you.
A I'm Anvi of class 10A and I'm going to be acting as Maneka Gandhi.
I'm Maneka Gandhi, born on 26th August 1956. I'm an Indian politician, animal rights activist and an environmentalist. And a member of the Lok Sabha and a member of the Bharatiya Janata Party. I was appointed chairperson of the committee for the purpose of central and supervision of experiments on animal in the year 1995. I had filed a public interest litigation that has achieved the replacement of municipal killing of homeless dogs with a sterilization program. In the year 1995, I founded the Peoples for Animal organization in India.
Namaste, I am Sunita Narayan. I was born in 1961 in New Delhi. In 2016, I was named to Time magazine's list of 100 most influential people. I'm an Indian environmentalist and political activist as well as a proponent of the green concept of sustainable development. I'm the Director General of the India-based research institute, the Center for Science and Environment. I'm also the Director for the Society for Environment and Communication. And I'm also the editor of the fortnightly magazine, Down to Earth. In 1989, Anil Agrawal and I wrote Towards Green Villages on the subject of local democracy and sustainable development. In my years in the center, I have studied the relationship between environment and development and worked to create public consciousness for the need for sustainable development. In 2012, I wrote the seventh state of India's environmental reports, Excreta Matters, and it was an analysis on the urban India's water supply and pollution. I have received many awards, including the Padma Shri and Stockholm Water Prize. It is critical to protect the environment so as to reduce the destruction of the ecosystem. As humans, it is a moral obligation to protect the environment from the pollution and other
क्या हमें पता है कि आज हम एक बड़े प्राकृतिक संकट में हैं? हमें ये भी नहीं पता कि आज कितनी हवा, मिट्टी, पानी और जंगल हमारे बीच में हैं और कितना हमारा साथ देंगे आने वाले समय में। ऐसे बहुत से सवाल हैं जो प्रकृति के साथ जिनके उत्तर हमारे पास नहीं है। मैं अनिल प्रकाश जोशी इन सब को लेकर आपके बीच आपसे जोड़ना चाहता हूँ, आपके साथ भागीदारी करना चाहता हूँ और प्रकृति के उस नियम को तर्प आप सब को ले जाना चाहता हूँ, जो ये कहता है सौभाग्यता से चारी एक दूसरे से जुड़े हुए तमाम तरीके से नए और पुराने जितने भी हमारा व्यवहार है उसकी जानकारी हम सबके बीच में हो, और इसलिए मैं और मेरे साथी आपके साथ एक संवाद की शुरुआत करेंगे ताकि आने वाले समय में प्रकृति और पृथ्वी को ना समझने की कोई चूक हमसे ना हो सके और हम आने वाले समय को एक बेहतर दर्जे से तैर कर पाए, उस पृथ्वी के लिए भी, प्रकृति के लिए भी और हमारे लिए भी। और इसके साथ मैं आपसे अगली कड़ी में इन सब बातों को लेकर आपसे जुड़ूंगा। आपको प्रणाम।
गुड मॉर्निंग एवरीवन। Today, I, Bhus Khattar of class 10th, would be enacting the role of honorable environmentalist Sundar Lal Bahuguna. Hello everyone, my name is Sundar Lal Bahuguna. I was born on 9 January 1927 in the state of Uttarakhand. I am a noted Garali environmentalist and a Chipko movement leader. The idea of Chipko movement was of my wife, and then action was taken by me. For years and years, I fought for the preservation of forest in the Himalayas. First, as a member of the Chipko movement in 1970, and later spearheaded the anti-Theri Dam movement. I have also won many awards like the Padma Bhushan, Padma Shri, and many other for my contribution to the environment. But I am a little tense nowadays because people are not at all caring for their motherland. So I would like to question all about why are we destroying the environment when we are born to help and save it. Just think about that question and please, please save the environment. Thank you.
Yes, I'm Yatim Makkar. I am an uneducated person but received worldwide recognition as an environmentalist for planting and tending trees across the state of Karnataka. I planted and tended 385 banyan trees along 4 km stretch between Kulikal and Kudur district, which gave me the name Salu Marada Timmakka. I have no kids. With the support of my husband, I find solace in planting trees. I have been honored with National Citizens Award, Padma Shri and Honorary Doctorate for my work towards environment. With no exaggeration, I would like you all to plant saplings as much as possible. Save environment for a betterment. I would like to end with a note by saying, the best time to plant a tree is just now. So friends, what are you waiting for? Thank you.
My name is Amrita Devi Bishnoi. Me, along with 363 other Bishnois, protested against the cutting down of Khejri trees in Khejri village in Rajasthan. The tribes of our village worship the trees and consider them equivalent to God. We hugged the trees so that those cruel people would not cut them, but they chopped us along with the trees. Our movement was the inspiration for the Chipko movement, which happened later on. I hope to this day that all the people of the upcoming generation will understand the importance of saving Mother Nature and realize our intention on sacrificing our lives. And I wish everyone should carry forward their love and respect towards nature.
Now here we have a creative CD art by Saisha.
Next, we have recycled bottle decor made by Vaidehi. Next, we have marine life degradation paintings by Tanushree.
We have the pollution paintings done by Sara. Now we have the pollution mask done by Haripriya.
Hello friends, my name is Droppy the Water Droplet. How are you? What a nice warm day is it? I am sweating. Oops, I'm sweating!
So cold. I'm
Hello. Is it heaven? Hello. My name is Manika Moisture. Hello, Manika. Do you know where we are? What happens if too many of us are in this cloud? What's happening?
Graceful greetings to our most beloved Principal Sir, Vice Principal Ma'am, CODs, teachers and my dear friends. The wheel starts rolling weeks ago. Every event in our life requires planning and bird's eye for detailing. It's my privilege to propose a vote of thanks speech and acknowledge the contribution of those who worked really hard to make the virtual science exhibition happen today. I must mention deep sense of appreciation for the wonderful experiments performed by my friends. The unthankful heart discovers no mercies, but the thankful heart will find in every hour some heavenly blessings. I thank one and all for making this program a grand success. Thank you.